Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Goblin Trilogy by Jim C. Hines. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Dylan Lynch, Tim Getman, Bradley Smith, Kimberly Gilbert, Richard Rowan, Colleen Delany, Eric Messner, Danny Gavigan, Alyssa Wilmoth, Thomas Keegan, Casie Platt, Scott McCormick, Patrick Bussink, Michael Glenn, Terence Aselford, and Gregory Gorton. Book 2, Goblin Hero.
Jig the Goblin was no warrior. His limbs were like blue sticks, his torn ear tended to flop to the side, and his fangs barely stretched up past his upper lips. As a child, he had been relegated to muck duty, hauling caustic sludge through the goblin lair to fill the firebowls that illuminated the cavern. The putrid, rotting plant smell of muck would seep into his clothes, his hair, even his skin. And muck duty was far from the worst he had survived. He tried not to think about his time cleaning privies. His grand quest a year ago hadn't changed him. Well, except for the nightmares about the dragon Straum coming back to eat him, or the necromancer casting a spell to wither Jig's body until it crumbled to dust, or giant carrion worms crawling into his bedroll and... Jig shook his head, trying to banish those images. Suffice it to say, he was still the same nearsighted runt he had been before. But he had emerged from the dragon's lair with one potent gift, the ability to heal various injuries. Given the nature of goblin life, this made Jig one of the busiest goblins in the lair. His current patient, a muscular goblin named Braff, was everything a goblin warrior should be. Strong, tall, and dumb, even for a goblin. Somehow, Braff had managed to wedge his own right fang deep inside his left nostril. Jig shook his head. Braff raised stupidity to new heights, then threw it down to shatter on the earth below. A dirty rag looped around Braff's jaw held the fang still.
Can you fix it? Don't talk.
Jig closed his eyes and directed his thoughts to Timilis Shadow Star, forgotten god of the autumn star. Jig had discovered Timilis Shadow Star during that adventure a year before. Or maybe Shadow Star had discovered Jig. Shadow Star was the one who gave Jig the power to heal the other goblins. What Shadow Star got out of the deal, Jig still wasn't sure. There were days he thought Shadow Star did it purely for his own amusement.
How much longer?
I'm sorry, I'm doing the best. How did he do this to himself anyway?
I'm guessing he had help. Someone tied those bandages onto Braff's head. Had Braff tried to do it, he probably would have hanged himself.
Goblins. Why did it have to be goblins? I think I'm ready now.
Good.
Jig crossed the small temple, trying to ignore the mosaic on the ceiling. Bits of colored glass formed an image of the forgotten god, a tall, pale man dressed in black. The face had a definite smirk, one that hadn't been there earlier in the day. Jig placed his hand over Braff's nose and tried not to grimace. Goblins had never been known for their attractiveness, and Braff was a spectacular example of why. Old disease scars dotted his skin, and his misshapen nose looked a great deal like a pregnant frog that had settled in the center of his face.
Now it looks like a frog with a huge yellow fang up its...
Hold still!
Jig tilted Braff's head back and slipped one finger beneath the bandage as he waited for the magic to start. The flow of Shadow Star's power through Jig's body always made him feel bloated, and he shifted uncomfortably as the magic warmed his hands. Before he could do anything more, a glowing orange insect landed on his arm and began to creep forward. Jig yanked his hand back. The last thing he needed was for the bug to crawl up Braff's nose. Glowing bug goo splattered over his arm, even as two more of the pests buzzed around his head.
What are they?
I don't know. They started showing up a few weeks ago and stopped talking.
Jig waved his hands, trying to bat them toward the spiderweb in the corner of the temple. The bugs drew back. Jig slapped his free hand over Braff's swollen nose.
Slowly?
A hair's breadth at a time, Jig slid the offending fang out of the nostril. Braff's eyes crossed. Jig's fingers felt like swollen tubers, and his arms tingled.
Got it.
Jig slid the tip of the fang free. The jawbone slipped back into the socket.
Thanks, Jig.
A variety of Braff's bodily fluids had misted Jig's spectacles. He slipped them off and wiped the lenses on his pants.
So how did you do this to yourself?
Ugh, it was on guard duty. My partner bet me I couldn't touch my nose with my fang. When I won the bet, he punched me in the jaw.
Ah, a splendid example of goblin etiquette.
I guess you showed him.
Yeah.
Braff turned to go. As he stooped through the low doorway, he hesitated.
Say, don't tell anyone I came to you. Some of the other goblins don't like you that much, and I don't want them to...
To think you've been coming to the runt for help?
Yeah, that's right. Thanks.
Braff disappeared down the tunnel before Jig could find anything to throw at him. Nearly every goblin had needed Jig's help at one time or another over the past year, but not one wanted to admit it. But some things never changed. No matter how many goblins he healed, no matter how many quests he survived, he was still Jig, the scrawny, half-blind runt. Jig sat down on the altar. A dark, red-spotted fire spider, the size of Jig's hand, crept up the side and scurried toward him. Jig straightened his arm so the spider could climb onto the singed leather pad Jig wore strapped to his right shoulder. Fire spiders grew hot when threatened, and Jig had the burns to prove it. Despite the scars, Smudge still made a better companion than most goblins.
It's not that bad. They can't afford to kill me. Who would fix their wounds?
Jig glanced at the blood on his trousers. Another improvement from a year ago was the quality of Jig's clothes. Jig had spent most of his adult life in a ratty old loincloth, so stiff he could have used it for a shield. Now he wore soft gray trousers and a loose black shirt. His old sword hung at his side, and he had his favorite boots on. The leather was bright blue, with red flames painted down the side and white furry fringe on top. Most importantly, he had his spectacles. Large amethyst lenses covered his eyes, letting him see the world as clearly as any goblin, except for his peripheral vision, where the lenses didn't quite cover. Steel frames kept them hooked over his pointed ears. They weren't perfect, and the frames irritated his bad ear, which had been torn and scarred in a fight with another goblin. But being able to see the world around him was worth a little pain. His thoughts were interrupted by Vika stepping into the temple, leaning on her ever-present staff, and drawing her long black cloak tight around her considerable bulk. The staff, like her cloak, was part of Vika's obsession with all things magical. An obsession that, unfortunately, included Jig. Broad-shouldered and thick-limbed, Vika had sent more than one goblin to Jig with missing teeth or a broken nose. Vika worked in the distillery, turning rotted fungus, smashed glowworms, and pungent mushrooms into muck.
Jig?
What do you want, Vika?
You didn't cast a binding spell when you healed Braff's nose. How did you do that?
I don't even know what a binding spell is.
Jig hopped down from the altar. He walked toward the tunnel and hoped she would move out of his way. Vika didn't budge. She raised a tight fist and slowly spread her fingers. Faint threads of light formed a dim, fragile web between her fingers.
The binding is the way the wizard taps into the magical powers that surround her. It is the first step of the journey toward...
One of the orange bugs landed on Vika's hand. The binding spell flickered out of existence. She smooshed the bug flat.
Stupid bug!
Vika, I can't.
Vika didn't let him finish. Scowling, she set her staff against the wall and fished through her clothes. From a pocket within her cloak, she produced a stained brown book. The cover had been torn off and re-sewn, and many of the pages were coming loose from the binding.
Joska says in chapter 2 that the hero will find a guide, a mentor to lead them to the path. You're the only goblin who knows anything about magic, and you won't even—
Who's Joska?
Vika tapped the cover. Oversized silver letters read, The Path of the Hero, Wizard's Edition, by Joska.
Joska says every hero follows the same path. Only the details change. I need a mentor. By refusing to teach me magic, you're blocking my way.
Joska should write an edition for goblins. In the first chapter, the hero sets out for adventure. In the second, he dies a horrible, painful death.
You survived?
An interruption saved Jig from having to answer. Braff shouldered his way past Vika.
I forgot. The chief said she wants to see you. It's about the ogre.
What ogre?
The one who showed up right after my problem. He smashed up a few other guards. He said he was looking for the Dragonslayer. The chief said to go right away.
Jig covered one of the muck lanterns and scooped up the other by the handle. Green light reflected from the dark red obsidian of the walls as he followed Braff into the tunnels.
Well, what do you think the ogre wants?
I'm more worried about what the chief will do to me for taking so long to answer her.
Ever since Kralk took control of the goblins, she had been looking for a way to get rid of Jig. He frowned, thinking about the rest of Braff's story.
Why didn't the other guards come to me for healing?
What guards?
The ones the ogre injured.
When I left, the older goblins were scrabbing what was left of them off the walls.
Jig began to run. Two guards stood outside the entrance to the goblin cavern. Fireballs provided a cheery yellow-green light. Jig ignored the blue bloodstains on the wall and floor. He flattened his ears as he walked inside. He had been away most of the day, and even the subdued, nervous conversation of 500 goblins was louder than he was used to. Smudge shifted restlessly on Jig's shoulder. Not that Jig needed the warning. The ogre was easy to spot. He sat near the back of the cavern, surrounded by armed goblins. Steel blades and long wooden spears trembled as the goblins fought to control their fear. For his part, the ogre didn't seem to notice. His leathery green skin was strong enough to turn away most attacks, and his hands were as big as Jig's head. He sat on the floor, probably because if he stood, his head would scrape the ceiling. His teeth were smaller than goblin fangs, but still sharp enough to sever a limb. He could cut a swath through the cavern barehanded. Shadowstar only knew what he could do with the huge, brass-studded club resting across his knees. Kralk, the lanky goblin chief, was smiling, which made Jig nervous as she walked toward him. She wore a necklace of jagged malachite spikes and an ill-fitting dwarvish breastplate. A nasty-looking morning star hung from her belt. Jig hadn't been around when the last chief died. At the time, he'd been around the fifth or sixth verse of the poem of Jig, somewhere between fighting the necromancer and cowering before the dragon. When Jig came back, many of the goblins had encouraged him to take over as chief, a prospect he found as appealing as dancing naked in front of tunnel cats. Ultimately, three goblins had emerged as potential candidates, ready to fight for control of the lair. The morning of the fight, only one of those three showed up for breakfast. The other two were found curled up near the garbage pit, with most of their blood on the outside of their bodies. Kralk had been trying to get rid of Jig ever since.
Jig! It's about time you got your scrawny arse down here.
This is the Dragon Slayer.
I'm Jig.
The ogre picked up his club and made his way toward Jig, keeping his head and shoulders hunched.
You're the one who killed the Dragon Strom?
Yes.
You put a spear through that monster's eye?
Yes.
You? You're the one they sing that song about, the one—
Yes, that's me.
The ogre knelt, peering down at Jig, then back at Kralk.
He's like a little goblin doll.
Braff said you wanted to talk to me.
That's right. We need help.
What was that?
Help. We need help.
What kind of help?
A few months ago, something showed up in Strom's cave and started hunting us. At first, we thought it was those hobgoblin types, or maybe you goblins. So we came up and slaughtered a few of you. Sorry about that.
You killed far more hobgoblins than goblins. We considered it a favor.
You're right. so you won't mind doing us a favor in return. Whatever they are, they've got magic on their side. Many of us have already died. Others have been enslaved. They're hunting down those who remain, the families who fled into the deeper tunnels. We've heard of you, Jig. You've got magic of your own, right?
Uh-huh.
Krauk's smile grew. Smudge responded to that smile with enough heat to sear the leather shoulder pad. Tiny threads of smoke rose from beneath his feet. Interesting that the goblin chief frightened him more than the ogre. Jig had always known Smudge was smart.
What do you say, Jig?
Jig took a step back. There had to be a way out of this. He whirled and pointed at Vika.
What about her? She can cast a binding spell and she wants to be a hero.
Sorry, Jig. If you had taught me magic, I might be powerful enough to help. But I guess you'll have to do this on your own.
But...
This is your path, Jig Dragonslayer, not mine. A hero must make her own path. To quote the valiant Duke Hoffman, who transformed himself to rescue the mermaid Lyriara, I have chosen my way, and it is the way of the squid.
What's she talking about? What's a squid?
Say yes.
What?
Jig closed his eyes, trying to concentrate on Timula's shadow star.
You want me to say yes?
I can't see everything that's happening, but I can tell you this much. Something about your ogre friend feels wrong. There's a residue of some sort, almost a magical shadow. Whatever's happening down there, it's dangerous. You have a choice, Jig Dragonslayer. You can go with the ogre and discover what's happening, or you can wait for the problem to come to you.
Waiting sounds good. What do you expect me to do? They're ogres. If they can't fight this thing, how am I?
You fought dragons and wizards and adventurers and you survived. Vika is peculiar, even for a goblin, but she's also correct. A hero is one who finds a way.
Krauk is trying to get me killed.
Or you can refuse. Tell the ogre no and see how he reacts.
Right.
Jig looked at the ogre.
I'll go.
Excellent.
The ogre slapped him on the shoulder.
Oops! Sorry about that. I forget how fragile you bugs are. Nothing broken, I hope.
The ogre grabbed Jig's arm and hauled him upright. Jig stepped back, testing his arm. Fortunately, the ogre hadn't struck the shoulder where Smudge was perched. The fire spider was crouched into a hot ball, staring at the ogre. With a burst of speed, Smudge raced down Jig's chest and burrowed into a pouch on his belt, leaving a trail of smoking dots down Jig's shirt.
Take Braff along for protection. Whoever's hunting the ogres might not have heard the poem of Jig. They might mistake you for a stunted coward and rip you apart before you have the chance to tell them of your great deeds. Someone else volunteered to accompany you.
I'm coming! I'm coming!
Jig will certainly need a nursemaid to look after him.
Grell made her way through the group to join Jig. If there was any goblin who would be of less use than Braff, it was Grell. The canes she used to support her weight were smooth sticks, dyed dark yellow with hobgoblin blood. Grell was older than any goblin Jig knew, with the possible exception of Golaka, the chef. But where Golaka had gotten bigger and meaner with age, Grell had shrunk until she was almost as small as Jig himself. Her face reminded Jig of wrinkled, rotten fruit. Grell had worked in the nursery for as long as Jig could remember, and generations of teething goblin babies had covered her hands and forearms in scars.
Are you sure? It'll be dangerous. The ogres!
Ogres? Spend a week with 23 goblin babies and another 9 toddlers. Then we'll talk about danger.
What about the nursery? Who's going to take over?
Riva's still in there, but you're right. Without help, they'll probably overpower her pretty quickly. Hey, Golaka, send one of your drudges over to help watch the brats. That should work. They can always threaten to barbecue the older ones if they get out of line.
Golaka peered out of the doorway.
My helpers are all busy mashing worms for dinner.
I only want one, and your worm pudding tastes like a week-old vomit anyway.
Last one who complained about my cooking got his tongue ripped out. The taste didn't bother him at all after that.
Par just send over whatever idiot overspiced the snake meat the other night. One day dealing with teeth and goblin babies, and they'll work twice as hard once they're back safe in your kitchen.
I like that. Hey, Pollock! Stop licking the hammer and get over here. I've got a new job for you.
Come on.
As they headed out of the lair and paused in the tunnel, Jig thought that his goblin companions might be worse than useless, but he could get used to having an ogre along. Jig studied the two goblins, staring at the object in Braff's hand.
What is that supposed to be?
A weapon, I think. I traded a hobgoblin for it a few days ago.
The so-called weapon was the length of Jig's leg. A thick wooden shaft ended in a brass hook, wide enough to catch someone's neck. The other end was barbed and pointed.
Do you know how to use it?
I wanted to name it first. I was going to call it a hooker, but that didn't sound right. I thought about calling it a goblin stick, because I'm a goblin, but I think I'm going to name it a hook tooth, because it's sharp like a tooth, only the other end is hooked, see? I wish I could remember where I put my shield, though. I had it at dinner last night because I used it as a plate, and I remember Melloc kept stealing my fried bat wings.
Grell's wrinkled face tightened with disgust. Shifting her balance, she raised her cane and slammed it into Braff's back. Braff hardly budged, but his face lit up. He craned his neck and patted the edge of the shield, still strapped to his back.
Ah! Thanks, Grell.
Jig turned to the ogre.
What's your name?
Walland Wallinson the Fourth.
The Fourth what?
The Fourth Walland Wallinson.
Couldn't the other ogres come up with enough names?
Braff seemed oblivious to the glare Grell shot him, so she slapped the back of his head.
Ow!
It's my father's name. He was Walland Wallinson the Third. His father was the Second, and my great-grandfather was Walland Wallinson the First. Your name is your legacy. Your family is everything. Anyone who mocks the Wallinson name had best prepare for a long, painful death.
He glared at Braff.
Seems awfully inefficient. All those ogres taking care of their own offspring. How do you find time for anything else?
Well, they don't stay young forever. Well?
Well, what?
Are we going?
Oh, right. Sorry.
Jig had forgotten he was supposed to be in charge of the other goblins. He raised his lantern, then hesitated. Going first meant leaving two goblins and an ogre at his back. Walland probably wouldn't do anything, not if he really wanted Jig's help. But the other two, well, they were goblins. Worse, Kralk must have talked to both of them before Jig even arrived.
What's wrong?
I'm wondering which one of you has orders to kill me.
Jig hoped his bluntness would startle the guilty ones into confessing. Instead, Braff and Grell glanced at one another, then at the floor.
Braff?
Kralk said she'd chop me up and toss me into Galaka's stew pot if you came back alive. She thinks you want to kill her and take her place.
Why? So the entire lair can plot my death instead of just you two? What about you, Grell? What did she promise you?
Oh, she said if I killed you, she'd make sure I'd never have to work in that miserable, foul-smelling nursery again.
You can't do that. Kralk told me to kill him.
Huh. Trustworthy bunch, you goblins.
Wallen came to us for help. He asked for me, for Jig Dragonslayer. I imagined he'd be very unhappy if something happened to me before we could help him.
I'm not afraid of some ogre.
But Braff tucked his hook tooth through the shield on his back and made no move to attack.
Grell?
The way I figured it, there's a good chance you get yourself killed down there and save me the trouble.
Fine.
Knowing she was probably right gave Jig a sick feeling in his gut, as though he had eaten something that wasn't quite dead yet. His only consolation, as he raised the lantern and set off down the tunnel, was that whatever killed him would no doubt kill the other goblins as well. Vika's books bounced against her sides as she hurried out of the goblin lair. She pulled her cloak tighter to minimize the jostling. She should have sewn more padding into the pockets. In her mind, she practiced the grand speech she had worked up to explain her departure to the guards. she would start by saying she had heard the call of destiny and had decided to set out on her own to fight the invasion of their mountain home. The path promised great danger and mighty trials, which only the greatest of heroes might survive. She stopped when she reached the guards, who were in the middle of a game of roaches. Both guards stomped their feet, each trying to scare the three roaches toward the other side of the tunnel. The goal was to get them to flee past your opponent without touching either the roaches or the other goblin. The game usually ended with crushed bugs and broken toes.
Aren't you going to challenge me?
Move, you stupid bug!
Ahem, I said...
I heard. Who do you think I was talking to?
The first guard took the opportunity to jump in front of the closest roach, sending it racing back. Vika hunched her shoulders and hurried past. She tried to comfort herself with the fact that many heroes endured the mockery of their peers. She had set out on the hero's path, and when she returned, she would have the power to punish all the goblins who had laughed and jeered over the years. The first chapter of The Path of the Hero talked about the refusal, when the hero first sees the path and turns away. Vika wasn't sure why the hero did this, especially since they all ended up on the path anyway, but Joska was adamant. All true heroes began by turning their backs on the path, just as Jig had done when he tried to get Vika to go with the ogre instead of him. Fortunately, Jig had given her the perfect opportunity to announce her own refusal, and she got to make Jig look like a fool at the same time. Served him right for hoarding all that magic for himself. The last trace of light disappeared behind her as the tunnel curved to the left. Vika moved to one side, brushing her fingers along the grime-covered wall as she walked. She had brought a small muck lantern from the distillery, but any light would make her far too visible. The smell of the air changed as she walked, taking on the musty scent of animal droppings and hobgoblin cooking, both of which smelled equally foul to Vika's nose. She had come this way only twice in her life, both times sneaking through with other goblins to raid Straum's lair below. That was where she had found her spellbook, along with her copy of The Path of the Hero. Vika hurried through the tunnel until she caught a glimpse of Jig with the hobgoblin guards. Jig had left his companions behind, facing the guards alone, as a true hero should. The twisting of the tunnel meant she couldn't see the hobgoblins. The other goblins and the ogre all waited before the bend.
We need to get to the lower tunnels.
Is that so? What did you bring for the nice tunnel guards?
Fresh cooked meat. Maybe some of that spicy lizard tail your chef makes with fire spider eggs.
If you haven't got that, we could always settle for a few strips of your flesh.
We haven't got any food to spare, so you're gonna have to settle for strips of flesh.
Vika crept closer, hoping the other goblins wouldn't look back. Jig waved his hand at the ogre, who lumbered into the light.
Why don't you start with his?
Go right ahead.
Hey, don't let us stop you.
Jig signaled the others. They passed by the hobgoblins and continued down the tunnel. Vika waited for them to leave. Now it was her turn to face the hobgoblins. She braced herself for the encounter. Aside from her books and staff, she had brought very little. Her muck lantern, currently hanging from her rope belt. Her wizard's staff. A skewer from last night's dinner, which she had swiped to use as a weapon. Bits of blackened rat meat still stuck to its length. At first, she had tried to carry it up her sleeve, but after twice stabbing herself in the armpit, she settled for tucking it through her belt and hoping it didn't fall out. Vika straightened, throwing her shoulders back and attempting to walk with the proper confidence and poise of a hero. The hobgoblins watched from the junction of the tunnel. Both stood at least a head taller than Vika herself. One leaned his weight on a thick spear. A curved sword hung from the belt of the other, who was sipping what smelled like beer from a bloated skin. A statue of a hobgoblin warrior stood beside the guards. Made of black glass, the statue marked the border of hobgoblin territory. It towered over the guards, the spikes on its helmet nearly touching the ceiling. A burning lantern hung from the left fang, gleaming off the statue's angry scowl. Structurally, hobgoblins resembled larger, uglier goblins. Their skin was yellower and their muscles stronger, but they had the same sharp fangs protruding from their lower jaws, and large goblinesque ears topped the broad heads. Between the gods and the statue, Vika felt like a child. For Vika, used to being the largest one in any group, it was an unpleasant feeling. The one with the spear scratched a long scar cutting down the side of his face. Vika mentally dubbed him Slash. After a cautious glance down the tunnel, probably to make sure Jig and the ogre were really gone, he sneered.
Another rat eater.
Forget rats. This one looks like she's eaten a whole tunnel cat.
I am Vika. I go to join the others in their quest.
Is that so? Well, if that's the case, go right ahead. If you hurry, you should be able to catch them before they reach the lake.
Thank you.
As she passed, Vika saw a nasty grin spread across Slash's face, but before she could react, he yanked back with his free hand. In the ceiling, a wooden panel gave way. Vika was showered with sharp rocks.
Ow! Damn it!
Vika stumbled forward, clutching her head.
I told you, rocks don't do enough damage. We need to mount crossbows to the ceiling.
You can't leave a cocked crossbow on the ceiling. They lose tension, and the strings will rot, especially with all the moisture from the lake.
Look at the rat eater. All your little rock shower did was make her cry.
We need bigger rocks, that's all.
Vika reached for the skewer tucked through her belt. Instantly, both hobgoblins raised their own weapons.
Don't be foolish, little goblin.
Not so little, really.
Vika's hand shook, she was so angry. But there were two of them, both better armed than her. And no matter how badly they had humiliated her, they had allowed her to pass. She straightened her robes, brushing away the dirt and pebbles. This was only the first step on the path, she reminded herself. Every hero suffered setbacks and failures in the beginning. That's why the first part of Joska's book was subtitled Stumbling Along the Path. She rubbed a lump on her forehead as she hurried down the tunnel. Vika moved fast enough to catch a glimpse of Jig and his companions as they reached the underground lake, the passage to the lower tunnels. A stone archway stood at the edge of the lake, a long tunnel stretching down beneath the water. A long swath of black sand covered the open stretch before the lake. No matter how quietly one moved, the scrape of that sand was more than enough to summon the guardians of the lake, the poisonous lizard fish. Jig and the other goblins used their weapons to knock swarming lizard fish back into the water as they crossed the sand. The ogre didn't bother. His bare feet stomped lizard fish into pale pink goo. The lizard fish kept coming. The white-skinned creatures were as long as Vika's arm, with clawed front feet to drag their bodies through the sand. Their bulging eyes swiveled independently, giving them addled expressions. Long white antennae flattened against their necks as they attacked. As she watched, another lizard fish scurried up to the ogre and whipped its tail about, jabbing the needle-sharp spines of its tail into the ogre's leg. The ogre kicked it across the cavern to slam against the wall. Vika stared. Lizard fish spines had enough poison to kill a full-grown goblin in the time it took to scream. The ogre had barely noticed.
Come on, Wolland!
With one last stomp, the ogre followed them into the tunnel. From the look of it, he had been enjoying himself. Vika untied her robe and grabbed an old grooved firestone from the pocket of her apron. Setting a muck lantern on the ground, she felt the end of a staff until she found the metal striker dangling by its cord. She drew the striker through the groove in the rock, shooting sparks into the lantern. The muck came to life, spreading green light through the cave. Black sand covered the ground in front of her. The water was still, smooth as black glass, save for the occasional ripple or bubble where lizard fish and other creatures surfaced in search of insects. Toward the back, water dripped from the rock overhead, too far away to see. Bits of broken green malachite studded the roof of the cavern, sparkling in the light of her lantern. The truly impressive formations were farther out, beyond the reach of greedy hobgoblin hands. Years ago, the only way down to the tunnel had been through an enchanted whirlpool at the center of the lake, but generations of adventurers had left their marks throughout the mountain, blowing up bridges, smashing doors, triggering rock slides that blocked various tunnels, and generally making a mess of the place. At least the tunnel through the lake was a useful alteration. Vika grabbed her lantern and stepped onto the sand, Instantly, the lizard fish returned, swarming from the water and spraying sand as they dragged their bodies toward her. Vika leaped back into the tunnel, and the lizard fish slowed. Their claws couldn't find enough traction on the bare obsidian, so lizard fish rarely left the sand of the beach. Unfortunately, the sand covered every bit of stone between Vika and the lake tunnel. This wasn't fair. Jig hadn't done anything heroic to get past the lizard fish. His ogre had done most of the work. All the goblins had to do was knock away the few lizard fish the ogre didn't smush.
Oh, I want an ogre of my own.
Vika tried again, moving as softly as she could, but it was no good. The instant the sand scraped beneath her feet, the lizard fish returned.
There has to be a way past.
There was always a way. She couldn't fail now, only a few steps into her journey. She sat down in the mouth of the tunnel and drew her spellbook from her cloak. The spellbook was in even worse shape than her copy of The Path of the Hero. Charred red leather covered engraved copper plates that formed the cover. The metal itself had survived the flames, but the pages hadn't been so fortunate. Those few that weren't burned beyond legibility were incomplete and blackened around the edges. That was to be expected when you grabbed your spellbook from a dragon's lair, she supposed, as she leafed through the charred pages. As Jig climbed down into the cavern where the ogres made their home, the first thing he noticed was the cold. The wind made him shiver, especially where it slipped up his sleeves and down his back. The second thing he noticed was that the last few rungs of the ladder were too insubstantial to support his weight. Unfortunately, he noticed this only when his feet slipped through the rungs. Jig retrieved his lantern. He scooped sand from a pouch on his belt to extinguish the flames.
Something's wrong with the ladder! The last three rungs aren't completely there!
Like breath!
Jig ignored her. He was too busy trying to absorb the changes to this place. When the dragon Straum lived here, he had used his magic to recreate the outside world. Straum had been trapped, doomed to remain as a guardian for various treasures, so he had done everything in his power to make himself at home. Jig remembered blue skies overhead. Some elements of Straum's world had been illusory, such as the sun that crossed the sky each day. Others were real, like the trees and plants Straum had spread throughout the cavern, feeding them with his own magic until his woods were a match for anything in the outside world. Those trees were bare and skeletal now, encased in a thin layer of ice. The ice was everywhere. The whole place had a faint, smoky smell, reminding him of the crude forge back at the Goblin Lair. Jig knelt, and the grass crunched beneath his knees. He broke off a single blade and studied it. Was he only imagining the silver swirl of light trapped within the ice? Frigid water trickled down his palms as the ice melted. The grass inside was brown and brittle. He blinked and squinted, flicking the grass aside to study his own hand. His skin appeared faded, having taken on a faint bronze pallor. Looking around, he saw the same metallic tinge everywhere. The ice sparkled silver, and the trees had the dull tarnish of old lead. The illusory sky had a dull gray glow, and there was no sign of Straum's false sun. Walland dropped down beside Jig.
Hideous, isn't it? The change was slow at first. Cold winds coming from Straum's cave. Frost spreading over the grass each morning. The leaves withered and disappeared. And then there's the snow.
Walland was interrupted by the arrival of Braff, who either hadn't heard or had forgotten Jig's warning about the ladder. He got to his feet, brushing ice and snow from his clothes as he moved around behind Jig.
Someone get me off this stupid thing!
Grell's canes were hooked over her belt, and she clung to the ladder with both hands. One foot gingerly poked the rung below. Black specks shot away from the rung as her sandal passed through it. Walland reached over and plucked her from the ladder. A rustling at Jig's waist made him glance down. Smudge was using his forelegs to push his way out of the small pouch on Jig's belt. His head appeared and took in the world around him. It promptly disappeared again. Jig wished he could do the same. He started to tie the lantern to his belt, trying to find a place where the hot metal wouldn't burn his legs. Finally, he hooked the handle over the hilt of the sword, so the metal rested against the scabbard. He ended up shifting several pouches to the other side of his belt to balance its weight.
Where do we go?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.